Welcome to another episode of the GCN Tech Clinic, where we answer and solve, or at least try to, your technical bike problems. So remember as well to leave yours down there in the comments section for me. Let's crack on then, shall we, with the first question this week, and it comes in from Aaron, who says they don't get to ride their race bike that often and they're concerned about the seat post seizing. It's a carbon post in a carbon frame. What's the best way to prevent it from seizing? Right, Aaron, don't worry too much, because carbon-carbon seizing doesn't generally happen that much. What I would recommend though is to actually use some carbon paste when mounting carbon with carbon, just to stop it from moving, in fact. Now, I was told many, many years ago by a frame builder that I used to hang around with to actually remove and re-grease all components every 6 months. And considering that back then we had cup and cone, headsets, bottom brackets, it was literally a ball ache to have to do that with all those ball bearings going everywhere. These days though, it is much easier and a lot less hassle to do so. So yeah, I still actually tend to just remove things very carefully and then re-grease them and then refit them. So that's a little tip from me. Now, Ben Ward has got a rattly problem, and I don't like rattles. They've got an irritating rattle, which they've finally diagnosed as the rear brake cable rattling in the top tube. Other than riding with my brake constantly on or moving house to a country where they have perfectly smooth roads, how can I fix this problem? Love this. So Ben, it depends on how accessible that internal cable is, but I reckon remove your seat post and actually try and enter the top tube via the seat tube, and you are going to want to slide. It's a bit of extra work because you are going to need to unclamp the rear brake cable and basically slide some of those tiny little rubber donuts onto that inner brake cable, and that should in turn stop the cable rattling. If you haven't got the time, patience, or energy to do that, again, remove the seat post from the seat tube and try and stuff some bubble wrap in there, because that is going to take up any of the space really where that cable could rattle against the tube. It's not going to weigh very much and it shouldn't affect your braking, and it should give you rattle-free riding. Now, Dave, they've got themselves an electrical question. I'm not an electrician, I must say, but I'm going to do my best with this. Why can't you get a hidden generator to charge all your tech while riding? So your Wahoo, your Di2, your power meter, and even your lights. I know you would lose speed or watts, but only if it was switched on. Good thinking here. So, you can get dynamo hubs, which can generate enough power to slowly charge up devices. Now, I don't know a lot about dynamo hubs, I must say, but I do know that touring cyclists use them, and obviously they can charge up their lights, mobile phone, GPS, that kind of thing. It would probably be quite a slow charge, but again, it does depend on the actual hub system of the dynamo. It does make me wonder though, the question, how long are your bike rides when you're worrying about these things running out? But a great question nonetheless, and I think one of our bike packing experts will certainly know the answer down there in the comments section, or at least I hope they do. Now, Mark wants to know, is it a viable option to deep clean your chain with petrol in order to apply a coating of chain wax? Right then, Mark, as dangerous as petrol can be, it is amazing for cleaning chains. It's not very good for the environment, it's not very good for you, so if you are gonna do it, just be extremely, extremely careful. From time to time, I have used it to clean a really, really messy drivetrain, and it has come up sparkling like the Queen's crown jewels. So yeah, it is an option, but like I say, and I can't say it enough, just be ultra careful if you are gonna use it. Now, Mike Threadgold wants to know, question about disc brake rotors. If I want to get a second set of wheels, so I have a set for road and a set for cross, should I match the brake rotors exactly, or do I just need to match the diameter and fitting system? Right then, Mike, ideally, I would say go for the same ones. That way, you are gonna get pretty much identical braking, because different rotors do give different braking, as well as you will have exactly the same thickness of the rotor, because rotors, they can even wear out. As for the actual alignment, you will be able to get them to work fine with some very thin washers if you don't want to buy the exact same ones. Hopefully, you're going to go out and buy yourself some new pair of wheels. Now, Overlow91, I have crossed the first 1000K on my new bike. Nice work. What maintenance checkups should I be performing on it? What are the milestone checks maintenance on bikes in general? Right, so first up, I'd have a check of the indexing of the gears because the inner gear cables can stretch a little bit and not give you that perfect, crisp, smooth gear changes. So if that has happened, maybe just a quarter of a turn or half a turn of the barrel on your rear mech or your inline cable adjusters, that should take up any slack there. Also, with your brake cables, sometimes they need to just be unclamped and just pulled through a fraction because, again, they can stretch too. As for any milestone marks on bikes, I can't think of any. All I do myself is actually just take a good look at it. I did years and years ago actually used to write down how long I'd got out of certain chains or how many Ks I've been doing on it, and then I would try and perform some kind of algorithm and basically know when to replace chains, that sort of thing. But really, when you're cleaning the bike, have a good look and inspection on it. And I would always invest in a decent torque wrench too, to make sure that all your bolts are up to the correct torque settings. Now, Dark Rollo, they are going to be moving to live in a hilly country. Would an 1132 cassette be more suitable than 1128? Right then, Rollo, yeah, in a word, it would. Now, you are going to have slightly more widespread ratio, so bigger jumps between some sprockets, more than likely in the easier gears, so in the lower gears, so actually when you're up there in the mountains. But yeah, 1132 is going to be easier for you than an 1128. I must say, I'm not that envious about you moving out to a hilly country. Only joking, hills are absolutely fantastic. Go out there, enjoy yourself. Now, BMAC 8691, they're planning on switching from 5339 with an 1123 to 5034 and 1128. The question is, will their 7800 Shimano Durace rear mech work with that new setup? They've read some say it will work and some say it won't. Shimano says a 27 tooth maximum. Right then, going to a compact setup, I see. I have it on very good authority that that will work. Shimano, like you say, do say a 27 tooth minimum, but I have heard of people doing it, and I do know a friend of mine, he managed to get a 28 to work fine on there. When you fitted that 28 tooth cassette, actually take a look and make sure that your upper pulley wheel is far enough away from the 28 cassette. So you are gonna probably need to just turn that B tension screw a little bit just to try and drop it down a little bit. Happy riding. Final question is from Jar J Choi. What's the relation between rim width and tyre width? Can I put a 35C cyclocross tyre or even wider on a normal road bike rim? Whew, can of worms, because tyre and rim combinations, some can absolutely slip on and be so easy, others you can wrestle away for hours and hours and hours and the tyre still doesn't go on. But you should be able to fit one of those tyres onto a standard road rim because years ago, well, we used to put 28C or 30C or 30mm, sorry, wide tyres, cyclocross tyres on standard road rims. So you're going to be putting a 35 on, which is going to give you 2.5mm extra either side. Doesn't sound a lot, but it can be the difference between a tyre going on really easy and not going on very easily at all, but I think you should be able to do it. If in doubt, pop along to a local shop and ask them to have a look and recommend, because without knowing the exact internals of that rim, I'm afraid I can't help any further. There we are, that is it for another GCN Tech Clinic. Remember, if you have a question or a query or a problem, something that is bugging you with your bike, let me know down there in the comments below and I'll do my best to answer it in a future episode. Also, remember to like and share this video with your friends and make sure you subscribe, click the button. And failing that, if you've not already done this, which I hope you have, click on the notification bell so that you get alerted each time we post one of our very cool videos, let's face it. And then remember to check out the GCN shop. You can buy things like this jumper I'm wearing right now. You can look as cool as me at shop.globalcyclingnetwork.com. And then for two more great videos, how about clicking down here and down here?